And after this miracle that happened a few moments ago, I am putty and shaking and feel like my mind is scrambled eggs. I don't even know if I can hardly talk, to be honest with you. I sat there a few moments ago thinking, Lord, help me even get my thoughts together. I just want to go lay in the floor and speak in tongues all night and cry and give Jesus praise. Hallelujah. But I also want to leave you with a word that is important to my heart, to feel that before you and I parted, that I would have been able to leave you with some very important things that I want you to know. You know, it's just when I look at your faces, I don't even have words to tell you how much I love you, what this love that God has put in my heart for you, to watch you worship all weekend, and I see you worship. I loved it. It's my favorite part. Besides just seeing his face, my favorite part is to look at your faces when you see him and when you worship him. And then I look at you in every conference, every time, as I look across this room and all in the altars and looking like this right now, I just look at you and wonder, oh, I just wonder who you are in the kingdom. I wonder what destiny is looking at me. I wonder about the gifts that God has put inside of you. You know, I was telling the leaders this afternoon, and it's true. I was watching Pastor Micah preach the first night. And while he's preaching, my mind is remembering the 15-year-old boy who came in the ramp with his baseball hat on backwards, who was addicted and bound to pornography and depression and suicidal thoughts. And what my mind is remembering is the boy that threw his baseball hat down when he answered the altar call and threw his arms up in the air, and watching a 15-year-old boy grow in God and then see what God is doing through him now. Watching Casey Doss this morning, I'm looking at Casey. You're hearing this man of God. I'm remembering the young boy I saw preach for the first time and looking at him back in outside of from the woods of Brilliant, Alabama, which is out the woods in Hamilton, Alabama, where I'm from. And I'm looking at this young boy just as the ramp had just begun, and I'm seeing the touch of God all over his life. And I look at you then and just think, who are you? Who is in your sphere of influence? Who have you been assigned to reach when you leave this place? It's important, oh dear God, so important to me. Can I just do a mother talk? Please, let me. Please. Now listen, I know you're tired, but I'm going to need you to help me, all right? All right? So just talk to me and answer me and help me out, all right? Thank you. You're the best. I wish we could just all live together all the time and worship God every day. Wouldn't that be fun till Jesus comes? I want you to make it. When you leave this place and you leave this conference and you get home, I want a year from now to hear from you. Maybe you'll come back to the next winter ramp, and I want to see you burning for God even far more than you are tonight. 12 years, I want you to come up and say, Miss Karen, I was at that winter ramp, and I've never looked at one pornographic image since that night. I want to see that guy. I want to see you come up to me 33 years from now, and while I'm sitting there with my cane, and you say, Miss Karen, I've been serving on the mission field ever since winter ramp of 2018. Come on. Oh, I want to see you finish strong. I wrote down thoughts this afternoon, and I'm just going to try to stick with them so that I can maybe, who knows what I'll do, so I can try to stay on track the best that I can. God brought you here this weekend to be awakened to the reality of his presence. I've watched him this weekend get rid of the junk in your life and in our lives so that we could see him more clearly and hear him. When you came in this room Saturday night, some of you were bogged down with shame and condemnation and guilt. It's always so interesting to watch the first night of the conferences when young people come in, and I can just see the battle that they've been in, the spiritual warfare they've been in. You can see how the enemy has been trying to destroy their lives. And then I watch the transformation when his presence comes in, and I see you standing in that presence, receiving it. And now look at you tonight. We wonder what the difference is from the first night to the last night. It's what it looks like when people dance and worship with no chains, no chains, no bondage, no condemnation. You know what it looks like? It looks like heaven's going to look like. That's why we can have heaven on earth. I want you to learn to live in this place of his presence. Listen to me and listen good. Sit up straight the best you can on a hard floor. I want you to learn to live, say live, in the place of his presence. This does not have to be just a weekend high. It does not. I'm telling you, I've served Jesus 50 years and I am burning more tonight for God than I've ever burned in my life. I know the ramp can't go home with you tomorrow. These lights and all the sound system can't go home with you, but he's going home with you. And he's the main thing. Come on. He's the everything. He's the all that matters thing. And he's going to ride in the car with you. He's walking in your house with you. He's walking in your bedroom with you. I want to encourage you because he is going with you. Look at Miss Karen. I want to encourage you to protect this good work that God's done in you. I mean, guard it with everything you've got. Because even Jesus said that immediately the enemy will come to steal the word. He'll probably try to get you offended or something even before y'all get home in the van. Just rebuke him and he'll flee from you. Resist him and he'll flee from you. You now have authority over that devil. You've got authority over him. You don't have to just put up with anything anymore. Shout, I've got a made up mind. Protect this good work. On the chosen, you're so precious. Look at you. You may be seated. Oh, my goodness. I love those guys, girls. All of them. But you can stand up and back me, though, anytime you want. And holler and all that. On a practical sense to protect this, listen to me. Don't think you'll remember the things that you've heard from God this weekend. Go home and write them down. Get a journal, write them before you leave town. Write down the stuff, date it, and I mean, it's a big deal because a few years from now or when you're struggling, the enemy's coming in, you can go back and look at what God said and say, no, I've got the proof right here. I hear it, but that's my word right there. I remember what he said. Don't think you'll remember it because you won't. You'll forget it. The enemy's after that word. You've got to write it down and protect it. Clear out the distractions. It was a lot of the distractions you came in here with you on Saturday night. So protect yourself from distractions that's out to steal what God gave you. That's what Pastor Micah was preaching to us partly about the other night. Revelation and living with restraint. Let your spirit lead you when you leave this place, not your flesh. That's what Perry taught us. You remember that? Clear out the junk in your life and keep it out. You've already cleared it out. You've done that all day yesterday. He was just getting rid of junk, breaking junk off of you. Keep it out. And I mean, keep it cleaned out. Like in your life, literally in your house, in your bedroom, when you get home. This is a big deal. I mean, just practically. Make your bedroom a sanctuary for the Holy Ghost. He's going with you, and because of that, don't do anything. Don't allow anything to grieve this holy friend that's going to be with you all the time. Protect him. Protect him in every way from being grieved. That's why the word says, grieve not the Spirit of God. Protect him in conversations that you're having with other people. If you're at school, there's conversations being had that's horrible and blasphemy, just mess and flesh. You need to take your friend, the Holy Ghost, and just move him. We just need to go over. You need to protect the Holy Spirit. Catherine Kuhlman, a mighty woman of God. Remember her, Judy, and how she was about the Holy Spirit, about protecting her friend. Oh, I love that. He'll protect you. You respect and protect him. Get anything out of your room that would grieve him. If that's his sanctuary and that's the place you're going to be meeting with him, go through your room. Clean out pictures. Clean out DVDs. Anything at all. Anything that would grieve the Holy Spirit, get rid of it. Don't watch movies he wouldn't enjoy. Don't listen to music he wouldn't like. Come on. Come on. That's one of the things with Chosen. It's a big commitment to us. We don't allow ourselves to be entertained by anything that would grieve the Holy Spirit. If his name is blasphemed one time, the movie's off and we leave, right? That's right. Because we don't grieve the Holy Spirit. Protect your spirit. Last night, the Holy Spirit baptized many of you, and you were filled with boldness. It's going to cause you to have the boldness to do what Jacob Peterson preached about the other day. Crazy things he may tell you to do in school and your university. But to sustain this fire that God has put in you this weekend, I want to tell you a couple of things that I want you to take home with you. Are you ready? Number one, Casey Doss preached it this morning. If you want to sustain what God has done in you, you can't just think you're just going to go home and, like he said this morning, just jump around and holler and it's going to be all right. No, you've got to stay in the Word just like he said. You've got to feed yourself on the Word. Read it every day. Say every day. Come on, shake yourself right now. In the name of Jesus, Lord, I pray you'd give them strength right now. I pray, I bring into captivity every thought in this room because they need this, Lord. So help them take it in Jesus' name. Now sit up straight and look at me. Thank you. Thank you so much. I want to do my best to respect. I know how you feel, but I really want you to get this word, kids. Stay in the Word. It's everything. I told you this morning, it's not just a book with words on it. This is a voice. Watch me. Every question ever ask from Adam to now, every question in all humanity is answered in this book. Every question you'll ever have, any direction that you ever need in your life, your answers are right here. How sweet is our Father? You say, well, when I read it, I don't get that, because this book has to be revealed by the Holy Ghost. And now you've got the Holy Ghost. You've got the author. He's living inside of you. He's with you all the time. He wants to teach you. He wants to reveal to you the secrets of this book. You say, again, I told you. You say, I don't get it. Read it till you do. And then ask your friend, the Holy Ghost, reveal it to me, Lord. Read it until something speaks to you. When I was a little girl, I told the Lord I was wanting a horse real bad. I was about 8 years old. And I prayed and I said, God, if you'll give me that pony. Lord, if you'll just give me that horse. I was wanting it oh so bad. And Daddy and them were saying no. And I was still praying. I said, Lord, if you'll give me that horse, I'll read a chapter of the Bible every day for the rest of my life. Well, next day I got the horse. So that's been 50 years of every day reading at least, I mean, most time more, but at least one chapter a day from the rest of my life. I'm going to keep my commitment. I got the horse. He died, but I'm still reading my chapter. Hallelujah. You know why, though? I know it seemed like a little thing, but even as a child, as a little girl, reading those scriptures every day was putting something in me, a grit I was going to need someday in the storm. Stay in the Word. The second thing, this is where I'm hanging my hat tonight before we do this dance. You're going to stay in the Word when you get home. And honey, you've got to pray. No. You got to learn to pray more than ever before. It's always a learning process. You'll just never graduate to know it all. No, I want to invite you on the greatest journey of a lifetime. Oh, my. And that is a life of prayer. It's everything. Why pray? Well, I'm going to answer that. Why pray? Because prayer is to develop, watch me and listen, intimacy with God. Yeah, that's really the heart of it all. It's to be able to develop this friendship, this intimacy with your Father. Oh my, what a privilege. He so wanted it for us. He paid the ultimate price so that he could say back to us, even after Adam and Eve had sinned, you can walk boldly into the throne room. Come on in, so we can talk. No, prayer is not some burdensome, dreadful drudgery. It is the greatest privilege of your life. Anybody can do it. The educated, the uneducated, the poor, the rich, the youngest, the oldest. Everybody can pray. It's free. It doesn't even cost anything except your flesh. And it's the area Satan will fight you in the hardest. Now I'm telling you, it is the area he'll fight you in the hardest. Which ought to be proof enough to know, then there must be something important in it. I would hate to think that somebody that I loved very much just sort of dreaded having to talk to me every day. You know. I would hate to think that somebody like my husband that I love so much, that every day he just thought, oh, I've got to get my time in with Karen. You know, got to get that checked off the to-do. Okay. All right, got to get up early in the morning. That's usually the best time to talk to her, so I'll get on up. Let me get my clock set, though. I need that timer. I need that 15-minute timer right there. Okay, that's about all I got time for. So let me get that timer going, okay? Now my timer's working. Okay, Karen, I love you. I love you. You're beautiful. You're beautiful. You're wonderful. You're wonderful. You're good wife. You're a good wife, honey. And let me see, how much more time? Okay, let me think of something else to say. Let's see. Oh, Karen, I just thank you for all that you do for me. I just thank you. And, Karen, what a beautiful. Oh, you're so beautiful. You're just beautiful. Oh, beautiful, wonderful, wonderful. All right, now here's what I need from you, okay? Let me tell you what I need right quick. And all right, you understand all that? Okay, I got it. And thank you so much. Again, thank you for everything you do. And I'll see you back in the morning, I hope. All righty, I'll talk to you later. That'd break my heart to think that's what he thought he had to do. Or I wasn't going to love him. Prayer is a privilege. Uh-huh. It is the greatest honor that we have. That we can walk, you and me, here we are on this in this vast universe out here that God created with his word. And then in his word, he says, with the span of his hand, he set the heavens. There's more stars in heaven than there are grains of sand on every seashore in the earth. And then the word says he knows each star by name. And so here we are out here in this massive universe on this little dot called Earth. And here you and I are, the dots on the dot. And here we are just walking around on this planet that's out here hanging on nothing but the Word of God. And here we are out here. And you and I have the incredible privilege 24/7 to look up to the Creator of it all and say, Oh, Father, you amaze me. You just baffle me. You just blow my mind. Oh, God. Oh, I just love you, Father. Pray like that. Let him just amaze you. Seek to know him and pray from your heart. When you pray, he reserves his innermost secrets for those who will search him out, not just for casual visitors. He says, if you'll search for me with all of your heart, you will find me. That's right. He doesn't just reveal his secrets to people that's got their timer on, flipping through the Bible right quick, getting their work in. No. It's for people that pray with all their heart. and you'll find him. Here's the deal. I need to move quick. Okay, let me say this. I'm concerned sometimes for this generation, and why I like to talk about prayer to them is because I want to see this generation learn to pray as well as they love to sing worship songs. Sometimes it bothers me, I'll be honest with you, even at the ramp, when we were singing, and listen, I love to hear you sing, and there's nothing I like better. I'm jumping with the best of you, even at my age, and I love to see you worship. There's nothing more beautiful to me, but sometimes we get through with the song, and the music's off, and we'll say, guys, let's pray, and everybody that was singing their heart out and dancing is like this. Now, sweetheart, good music is not going to keep you. Good music is not going to sustain you. It will not. No, no, no. It's got to come from a place of the heart. And whenever you walk in intimacy with God in prayer, it'll change everything about your worship. I want to hear you pray. When you pray, after when I say let's pray, I want to hear you pray as loud as you sing. I want to hear you pray as passionately as you sing. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I remember when we first started the ramp in the early days, in the really early days, when there was like just a little handful of kids. And I remember they were just coming out of the world. Their lives were just all messed up and screwed up. And I was just starting to work with the kids. And I remember looking at them. We were in that old shopping center where we started. And we were all in a circle holding hands. I remember that day oh so well. And I was like, God, guys. I said, guys, if you pray, he will come. So let's pray. We're holding hands. I said, okay, guys, let's pray. And every one of them in the circle went. It's like we're going to say the blessing, not pray. We're not saying the blessing. We're going to pray. So you know what I had to do? Even in the awkward silence, I just prayed like I wanted to hear them pray one day. So within the circle, everybody's got their head bowed, and I'm just like, oh, God, in the name of Jesus. Oh, Father, we give you glory that you are here and you are with us and you are mighty and there's nothing like you in heaven or on earth. I remember one boy, he was a football player, and I remember I opened my eyes and my praying my guts out, and he was like, youth pastors, pray yourself like you want to hear them pray. Come on. Pray and pray a lot. Pray outside, my favorite place to pray. Pray in Walmart. You know what I do in Walmart a lot? I take my cell phone and I keep it on my ear and I just talk to God like he's on the phone with me, because he is. Because the Bible says pray without ceasing. I'm telling you nearly all the time. If you see me at Walmart, I'm going to have my phone and I'm just talking to God and I'm just praying, because I just know, I'm just hearing, I'm just thinking, Lord, I know you're on the other end of this phone. So I'm just going to, that way I can just keep praying in Walmart. They won't think I'm too weird. Pray in the car. Pray in your room. Pray every day. Pray quiet. Pray loud. Come on. Don't just get stuck on little bitty. I don't even think I need to pray. Talk to you about how to pray quiet. We got that down. Everybody's got it down. We're so good with that, I ain't even gonna spend no time on it. Learn. You've already got quiet, so learn to pray in every way. Pray loud. Learn to pray quiet. Learn to pray loud. Learn to open your voice. Use your voice out loud and pray. Go outside. If you're not used to it, you don't want to start with around other people praying loud because it makes you feel weird. Go outside and get all by yourself with God. That's my most favorite of anything in the world, is to go outside and pray with God by myself. And go out there where you're out there with him in the open sky and just look up and just say, I love you, God. Hallelujah. And I like to just see it. Sometimes I've just seen the heavens opened in the spirit. Yeah, listen, I found this scripture. You say, well, that's kind of weird. No, it's not. Hebrews 5:7, listen to this. The Bible says, well, while Jesus was here on earth, he offered prayers and pleadings with a loud, say loud, cry and tears to the one who could rescue him from death. If Jesus prayed that way, so should we. Prayer is a conversation. We talk and he talks. Let me tell you something. After, when you start praying, You'll be talking to God, but what's going to blow your mind is when he starts talking back. That's prayer. That's what prayer is. It's not just you all the time. Honey, he will. I don't have time, and I wish I did, could tell you my stories of how, they know some of them, how he has answered. I'm ruined. His voice has ruined me. I can't wait to start hearing your story someday of how he answers you. If you'll become a friend of God in prayer, he can trust you with the cares and the burdens of his heart. Listen to Miss Karen. Say, I'm listening. You'll begin to co-labor with his will on the earth. Watch me and please listen. Please. If you will pray regularly, say every day, he will speak his ideas and his dreams into your spirit. It will often sound God's voice in your mind when he's speaking to you. It'll often sometimes, especially in the beginning, sound like a thought. You just have this thought. You may say, was that you? Where would that come from? And watch, he'll start confirming his word. Listen, co-laboring with God in prayer means that I hear his heart. And he hears mine. I hear his ideas, and he loves mine. It's one of my favorite things about God, is that he lets us co-labor with him in the earth in prayer. If, listen to me, if you'll begin to keep praying and you develop this intimacy and friendship with God, you know what'll start happening? The more you develop that heart and that friendship with him, he begins to trust you with those secrets of his own desires. And what he does is he'll invite you into his council room. Oh my, I've been there. I've been there. Would you bring me a chair, please? Come on, please. I love, in my meal house where I like to pray sometimes, I will take a chair and I will put it down in the meal house just like this, because the Bible says now we are, that Jesus is far above, seated high, far above all powers, principalities, and every name that is named. And then Ephesians, the same chapter, says, and now we are seated with Christ in heavenly places. Oh my, oh my, no, there he is right there. And I got my seat, you got a seat, you've got a seat in the council room of heaven. Have you been sitting in it? Have you been using your chair? Come on, you've got a seat right there. It's yours, your name on that seat right there. Whoa, I love that. I pray like this a lot. Sometimes if he's far above all powers and principalities and I'm sitting with him up here in heavenly places, that means I may be praying on the earth, but my spirit is rising up, 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 far above the problems, all the mess, all the circumstances, and from a heavenly place, I sit down with God and I commune with Holy Ghost. I commune with Father, Son, Holy Ghost. I commune there and I hear his will. And from that place in the heavens, I begin to decree on the earth what he is saying from the council room of heaven. Oh, I just love that. I love that from this earthly realm, here I am, but I'm actually seated from heaven and I'm speaking into things in the earth and I'm calling them to line up with the will of God. Oh, hallelujah. You know, one of my favorite things about the council room of heaven is when it's just me and him talking, and I've been up there before with him in prayer. And what I love about God, he's so sweet. You know, we talk and we dream, and he tells me his dreams. And what I love is when he lets me tell him my dreams. He does that. He asks for our advice. God wants to know your thoughts on things. You're a friend of God. He's the one that put that creative nature in you. He's the one that gave you those ideas. He gave you the ability to think and dream and that entrepreneurial spirit and just crazy ideas you've got. And you know what? You sit there with him and he's like, well, what do you think about that? And then I can say to him, God, sometimes like, God, I've just had this incredible idea. I've been thinking about building a place called Camp Ramp. Up there, we put a bunch of cabins out there on that land, and we can have a prayer center, 24-hour prayer center, and he'll just start going, oh, I like that. That's a good idea. I love that idea. Come on.
And then he says, you just keep seeking me and I'll take care of it. See, he wants to know your ideas. He wants to know your dreams. Oh, my, my, my. See, y'all have already got me all distracted. Your dreams matter to God. Your desires matter to God. But does God's desires matter to you? Because God has desires too. He's not willing that any would perish. That's his desire, that none would perish. He wishes above all things that people would be whole and have every need met. But you know what I have found, and I'm going to move quickly if you will listen quickly. I have found God's desires. He restrains his desires in order to co-labor with man. God looks at this earth and all of its mess. His desire is that none would perish. But are people perishing? Yeah. His desire is that people would be made whole and have every need met. Are people sick and in poverty? What's the problem? Why? I mean, he's God. It's not like he can't fix it, right? He made a universe with his word. Why can't he just look at the woes of the world and just fix it all? Because that wasn't his plan. He gave us the choice. He wanted to love and be loved and co-labor together with his dream for the earth. Could it be that the woes of this world are not because God doesn't exist or he's not interested? Could it be because there are no intercessors? Because in Ezekiel, he saw a need on the earth. And here's what God does when he sees a need on the earth. Watch, Miss Karen. When God sees a need on the earth, he doesn't look at Cincinnati and go, ooh, look at that mess, and step out of heaven and go try to fix it. When God sees a need in Cincinnati, his desire is that they would not perish. So what does he do when he sees the need? He starts looking for a man. I need a man in Cincinnati. I need a woman. I need somebody that'll pray. And so what happens when he finds an intercessor? He finds somebody that can co-labor with him from the council rooms of heaven and get his will from heaven and become a conduit of faith to get his will from heaven through them into Cincinnati. Come on, that's what God does. That's what he's looking for tonight in this room, are people that will co-labor with him as friends of God to bring his will to the earth as it is in heaven. I don't care that you're 16. God will take anybody that will say yes to the call. Come on, listen to Miss Karen. The Bible says that the eyes of the Lord are just searching to and fro, just looking for somebody he can show himself mighty through. I want God to know in Cleveland, Tennessee, with your eyes searching everywhere, all over the earth, looking for somebody. I want you to know in Cleveland, Tennessee tonight, you found 2,000 people to say yes, yes, yes. No. Why is the world in the mess it's in? It's not because he's not willing. Could the answer be that he said, I give to you the keys of the kingdom of heaven? Whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth is loosed in heaven. I must hurry, please help me. John Wesley said this, and it rocked my world about 2 years ago. God does nothing in the earth except in response to prayer. God does nothing in the earth except in response to prayer. God does nothing in the earth except in response to prayer. If you don't believe that, and I had trouble with it too at first, because I didn't like the responsibility it put on me. I would just rather think it might be, you know, something with whatever. Most people just want to blame God rather than think they've got anything to do with anything. But God does nothing in the earth except in response to prayer. If you don't believe that, go read this Bible. The book is full of that. It matters when you pray. Or should I say, when you pray, it matters. And can I say, when you don't pray? In fact, the weighty responsibility of this is almost overwhelming. Especially when you realize the implications and the consequences that follow a prayerless church. Keith Green said it like this: this generation of Christians is responsible for this generation of souls. When you look at our role in intercession, this is what he says we are. When Lindsay was gone, my daughter Lindsay, beginning of 2014, my daughter Lindsay was targeted by the enemy with a spirit of deception that pulled her away and changed her to a different person. And during that season, I had a decision to make. I could do what people were telling me to do, accept it. She's a grown woman. You can't change her. You got to learn to move on with your life, Karen. Or I could go to God and find out what he had to say about what was happening to my daughter and stand on that word until she looked like that word. That's what I opted to do. Two years of intercession, every single day. It was more than 2 years, actually. Every single day, every day, every day. Someday praying till the sun came up in the morning. Praying all night long, and sometimes, all day and all night, many a night. I made up my mind. I made up my mind. I made up my mind. I'm not quitting until my daughter is delivered again. I made up my mind. And in that season, God showed me this verse, and I'd never seen it like this before. In 2 Corinthians, this is talking to you. In 2 Corinthians, this is what God says we are and who we are. It says, God has given us, through prayer, watch, the task of reconciling people to him. How many of you have someone you love that doesn't know the Lord? Raise your hand. Put your hand down. God has given who this task? That's right. This time say me. God has given who the task of reconciling people to him? Watch, kids. It says, so we are Christ's ambassadors. Watch. God is making his appeal through us when we plead, come back to God. What does that mean? I learned it when Lindsay was gone. I learned when she was gone. She moved to a different city, left her family, left the ministry. But I found out something. There's no distance in the spirit realm. So while she was in that other town, hardly speaking to me at times, I could be over here in the prayer closet in Hamilton, Alabama. And what I did, I took that verse literally. It said, God is making his appeal through me in prayer. I'm going to speak for Christ. In other words, God is praying through me when I pray. The Holy Ghost is praying through me for her whenever I plead this. As the Bible says, I took it literally. I went to the front porch, opened the door. I'd go on the front porch of my house outside, and I'd go, Lindsay, come back to God. Lindsay, come back to God. Two years calling, praying, contending. Does it matter? Well, you better believe it matters. You know why? Because your friends and your loved ones, hold on my name, oh my. Your friends and your loved ones are depending on what you do in prayer. Let me tell you something. For some of these people you just raised your hand for, if you don't pray for them, who is? For some of those people that was represented by an uplifted hand just then, if you don't pray, nobody else is. And the fact is, when you become friends with God in prayer, he is putting them on your heart for a reason to pray. They are in your sphere of influence. You're the one that's got the responsibility in prayer as an intercessor for them. No, this is a big deal. I don't care if you're 12. You can move heaven and earth for them. Things will change when you pray. No, this is a big deal. No, kids, listen to me. Everything's depending on this. Watch me. Everything is depending on this. No, this is so serious. You've got to listen to me. No, this is about eternity. This is life or death. No wonder Satan fights your prayer life so hard. This is about their eternity. I wasn't going to do this because I felt like it was so late, but let me just finish. I'll read, and so I'll be quick. For those people you just raised your hand for, it's heaven or hell. No, that's why your prayer life is so important.
Not, it's, yes, ultimately everything is to know God. But what I'm telling you is, once you know him, you're going to start getting his heart. Once you start contending with him in intimacy, you're going to start getting his heartbeat. And I want to tell you what his heartbeat is. What the heartbeat of God is not for temporal things in this world. What the heartbeat of God is for souls. It's souls. It's souls. It's souls. It's for those that's on your heart tonight. That's why they came to your mind. When I asked that while ago, you saw a face. You saw a name. That's no coincidence. That's the heart of God communicating with you. No, it's heaven or hell for them. I know this is not a subject talked about very much, but hell's real. You don't hear it preached about very much anymore. In fact, a lot of preachers and ministers and churches and people that I know in ministry, and I've talked to them a lot, they don't believe in hell anymore. And they've told me, I've had long discussions with them about it. I don't even know how in the world you read this book and can come away without the fear of God gripping you for the reality of it. No, it's a real thing, kids. No, it's a real thing. That's why your prayers matter. We are in this sphere called time. Above us is eternity in heaven. Below us is eternity hell. That's the way I'm going to look at it tonight. You and I are in this little sphere called time. Come on, in eternity's line, it hardly measures. In fact, the Bible says that this thing called time for you and me is like a little vapor. It would even hardly measure on a line of eternity if you could see it in all of its, the truth of how long our little lives are. We've just got this little sphere called time, and here we are all in it. Above us, people that's already died, and they are now eternity in heaven, and below us are the screams of people in hell. They will never get out. They will never get out. God will never change his mind on it. It is set. If you read the Bible, it's the way it is. And it's so weird to me because nobody wants to believe that that's real. I've never gone to a funeral in my life ever to where the person that died. Every single time, every funeral I've gone to, the person that died is always in heaven. No matter how they lived in America, anybody that died, it didn't matter how they lived, what they were, what they professed, every single person that died went to heaven in America. I hate it. I wish it was true, but that's just not reality. That's just not the reality. That's just not reality. Y'all, this is not fun to talk about, is it? But I'm telling you, this is why pray. Why pray? Why pray? Let me tell you why pray. I'm going to skip some scriptures for time. Matthew 25:41 says, "Depart from me, you cursed, into everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels." It's what God says. Hell was never made for man. But whenever we choose a different master, we become a slave to the one that we obey. So when you choose the enemy, when you choose the fallen one, when you choose the rebellious one, Lucifer, then you follow him into his eternal judgments. I'll just read this one out of the Bible. And I don't know, people that don't agree with it, just deal with whatever this is. This is what the Bible says. Revelation 20. "And I saw a great white throne and the one sitting on it, and the earth and sky fled from his presence, and they found no place to hide. I saw the dead, both great and small, standing before God's throne, and the books were open, including the book of life. And the dead were judged according to what they had done, recorded in the books. The sea gave up its dead, and death and the grave gave up their dead. And all," say all, "were judged according to their deeds. Then death and the grave were thrown into the lake of fire. This lake of fire is the second death. And anyone," say anyone, "say anyone whose name was not found recorded in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire." The next verse up here in verse 8 says, "Cowards, cowards, cowards, unbelievers, the corrupt, the murderers, immoral, people who practice witchcraft, idol worshipers, and all liars, their fate is in the fiery lake of burning sulfur." Why pray? Why pray? Because when you pray and you get the heart of God, this matters to the heart of God. That's why he doesn't want anyone to perish. It's not his will. It's not his desire. One more. Just one more.
Holy Ghost, come and help me right now, Lord. Help me.
Luke 16. Jesus told this story to his disciples. There was a certain rich man, which tells you right there, this is no parable, that he's just using like a little allegory for an example of something that wasn't true. No, it's a certain, say certain. It's a certain man. It's a certain rich man who had a, hang on. Don't you hate it? There we go. There was a certain rich man who was splendidly clothed in purple and fine linen and who lived each day in luxury. And at his gate lay a poor man named Lazarus who was covered with sores. Lazarus lay there longing for scraps from the rich man's table, and the dogs would come and lick his open sores. Finally, the poor man died and was carried by the angels to be with Abraham. The rich man also died and was buried, and his soul went to the place of the dead. There in torment, he saw Abraham in the far distance with Lazarus at his side. The rich man shouted, "Father Abraham, have some pity. Send Lazarus over here to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue. I'm in anguish in these flames." But Abraham said to him, "Son, remember that during your lifetime you had everything you wanted and Lazarus had nothing. So now he is here being comforted and you are in anguish. And besides, there's a great chasm separating us. No one can cross over to you from here. And no one can cross over to us from there." Watch. Then the rich man said, "Please, Father Abraham, at least send him to my father's home. For I have 5 brothers, and I want him to warn them so they don't end up in this place of torment." But Abraham said, "Moses and the prophets have warned them. Your brothers can read what they wrote." The rich man replies, "No, Father Abraham, but if someone is sent from the dead, they will repent of their sins and turn to God." But Abraham said, "If they won't listen to Moses and the prophets, they won't even listen if someone rises from the dead." Desta Mangan, a woman of God, many years ago preached a message. I never forgot it. Rocked my world on this very thing right there, on that subject of the rich man in hell. She said something that gripped me. She said, "His brothers are still here among us. And if today that rich man could still cry out to Abraham and Abraham here, he would probably say to Abraham," kids, are you listening to me? The rich man would probably say to Abraham, "Abraham, send somebody to warn my brothers. But send somebody who's been shaken. Send somebody who believes there's a hell. Send somebody who believes that there's a lake of fire. Send somebody who believes and knows that hell is no joke. Send somebody who doesn't believe that hell is just a swear word. Send somebody who lives for eternity and not just for time. Send somebody who's willing to forsake all and snatch people out of the fire. Abraham, don't send an average Pentecostal. Don't send somebody with no burden. Don't send anybody who doesn't care about the lost. Don't send anybody who won't even go to a prayer meeting. Abraham, don't send an average average church goer who just wants to go to church and be entertained and live an easy life and not care that the world's going to hell. Don't send anybody like that. Send somebody who will care, Abraham. Please, send somebody who will never quit. Send somebody who will never leave them alone. John Wesley said, I plant one foot in hell and one foot in eternity, and I snatch as many souls from the burning as I possibly can. Charles Spurgeon said, if sinners be damned, at least let them leap to hell over our dead bodies, and if they perish, let them perish with our arms wrapped around their knees, begging them not to go there. He said, if hell must be filled, let it be filled in the teeth of our exertions, and let not one go there unwarned and unprayed for. Why pray? What? No, 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 no. God does not want you to pray to get your little 15-minute time in. No, no, no. Everything's at stake. Everything's at stake here. Oh, na, na, my. Loko shabai. Put my clock up. I'm almost done. I'm mo shabai. You see that clock? You got it? I know it's not the right time, but I just wanted you to look at the second hand, because that second hand's what matters to me and you. This is the sphere of time. You and I are in it. No more for them, and no more for them. That right there. That's where we live. And every second that thing moves right there, every time that little second hand moves, and it's been moving since the moment God spoke time into existence. And the Bible says there will be a day when time is no more. But that second hand right there, it means every time it moves, that's how much closer you are to either heaven or hell. Every time that second hand moves, the one you just raised your hand for a while ago is that much closer to eternity. No, you got to get that. Oh, na, na. Listen, Peter said this. He said, listen, kids, in 2 Peter 3, Peter said, I want to remind you that in the last days, scoffers are going to come, and they're going to mock the truth, and they're going to say this. They're going to say, well, what happened to the promise that Jesus is coming again? Before the time of our ancestors, everything's remained the same since the world was first created. Watch. Listen. Verse 9, he says this, but the Lord isn't really being slow about his promise as some people think about his coming. No, he's being patient for your sake. In other words, why isn't Jesus coming? Why? The world is like it is. Why won't he just come on? I'll tell you why he won't come on. Peter told us right here. He says, no, he's being patient for your sake. Why? Because he doesn't want anyone to be destroyed. He wants everyone to repent. Come on. Listen, he says here, the day of the Lord is going to come unexpectedly as a thief. The heavens will pass away with a terrible noise, and the elements will disappear in fire. He says, since everything around us is about to be destroyed, since everything you look at is about to melt in fervent heat, Peter says, what manner of lives should we be living? Come on. Jude. In a little book written by the brother of Jesus, right before the last book of Revelation, in his little writing, Jude said to us, he said, be merciful to those that need mercy. And then he says this, and for others, he says, snatch them out of the flames of judgment. Why is that second hand still ticking? Because every time that hand still ticks, God knows, if
I can just wait, let it take. I can get that one. Oh, no. Just a little bit longer and I can grab. I can get her. Oh, come on, just a little bit longer. Oh, I hear her praying over here. Yes, I can work through that. I can work through that intercession. I hear that name, Charles. Yeah, if I can just wait a little longer. Yeah, keep praying, baby, keep praying. Because right now, if you'll just keep praying, I got him. I got Charles. Come on, that's what happens. That second hand's ticket. Come on, I hear her praying. I can work with that. I can reach him right there. You know, don't stop praying. Don't stop praying. It's working. Don't stop praying. Vesta told the story in that message I never forgot. Vesta's husband's a minister. And Vesta said that her husband preached the funeral of a 10-year-old boy who was burned to death in a house fire. Vesta said that her husband also was there at the house when the house was burning to see that little boy's mother outside that house trying to get in to save her little boy. He said it took 4 police officers to hold that mother back until finally they had to handcuff her and take her off in a car. Because that's what you do when you love somebody. Bring out the door. Bring out the door. They're going to do this dance. In this dance, this is the first time we've done it, but I wanted to do this tonight because I want to show you what I learned from experience about prayer. I want you, I don't care who you are and I don't care how old you are. I want to show you what happens, especially mothers and dads in here believing for a prodigal. But I'm not talking just to them. I'm talking to you kids on the floor praying for parents and siblings and best friends. I want to show you what happens if you'll pray. I'm telling you, if you pray, it matters, and if you don't, it matters. I want to show you what I experienced in my life when I saw God answer my prayers and destroy deception. Watch.
What about God's will for your life? You can't tell me God's will for my life, Mother. Nobody can.
No. But what about this book? What about this book you believed in for so many years, Alexis? Why won't you listen to me?
Why won't you listen to me?
Alexis, if you choose to walk out that door and take that road, it will cost you everything.
Well, I guess that's the price I'm going to pay then. That is the road I'm going to take because I'm doing it my way.
No. Truth, God.
Jesus' name, let the scales fall from her eyes. I capture her rebellious thoughts and teach her to obey Christ. Jesus. God, in 2 Corinthians 10:3, I am human, but I don't wage war as humans do. I use God's mighty weapons to knock down strongholds and human reasoning and false arguments. The captive of the warrior will be released. The plunder of the tyrant will be retrieved. In Jesus' name. I will save your children. I take authority over deception in Jesus' name. Alexis, come back to God. Alexis, come back to God. God, your word is truth. And the truth shall set her free. I take all authority in the name of Jesus. My daughter will come home in Jesus' name. Today is the day of deliverance. Today is the day of deliverance. God, you've made promises to me. You have not failed me yet. Break deception off of her in Jesus' name. Let the scales fall from her eyes, God. I trust you with my daughter. She is your daughter. She will come home. She will come home in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. I have seen her whip away. So much better your way.
There's a prodigal here tonight. You've managed to sit through this whole conference wondering if this was all real. But there's been somebody praying for you. Tonight's your night to come home. Tonight's your night to see deception destroyed over your life. And if you will run to Jesus, he has the power to annihilate, to completely destroy that spirit that has been tormenting your life and lying to you for so long. This is your night to be free. If you're the prodigal in this room tonight, you're the one that's been running from home and running from everything you've ever thought was real. I want you to get down here right now, move people out of the way, and just run to this altar. Come on. Come and come running. Come and say, I'm sick of sin. I'm sick of the pig pen. I'm sick of the lies. I'm sick of it all. I want to come home. I want to come home. Come on. Every prodigal in this room that's got somebody praying for you. Come on, move them from the back. Move, push people out of the way. I'm coming home. I'm coming home. I'm coming home. I want to come home.